time of crisis, the Roman Empire in turmoil.
Right. So they bring our friends bring this grognard looking war game out.
Well, the box looks like a grognard war
game. It's a GMT game. That's the company that makes the grognard war game.
Yep.
Right? So you're looking at this thing and you're like, this is not, what's this gonna be like, right?
What if I told you it is a deck builder?
Yep, like Dominion.
But it's a deck builder where every turn, at the end of your turn, you pick up your entire draw deck, choose the five cards you want to draw, and put the rest of your draw deck back down.
Right, so that's a real work of genius, right? Think about Dominion, right? So Dominion is the first real deck builder, right? And it sort of set the stage for all other deck builders. They all follow the basic template of...
And nothing has been better than Dominion.
You have a deck, right? It starts out with just a few cards. You draw some. You play them all. You put them all in the discard.
Yep.
You acquire more cards that also go in the discard. And then you draw more. But you shuffle and draw randomly. It's like, well, what if you could just stack the deck and draw whatever five you wanted every
But time. Everyone's stacking the deck.
Well, it's not that everyone's stacking the deck. It's that, okay, you're stacking the deck. So for people out there who obviously are more likely to have played Dominion, imagine you're stacking the deck in Dominion. Turn one, fucking five coppers.
Yeah.
Turn two, what? Two coppers and three estates? It's like...
If you blow your load on a big turn... You're effed until that discard reshuffle.
Right, what can you do? It's like, okay, and then you shuffle again. See, then you, all right, you got mine, now I do it again. All right, I'm going to do four coppers and the village that I bought or whatever, whatever card it was that I bought, right? It's like, but then you get to the end of your deck and your discard is full of all the good cards that you stacked to make beautiful hands. And I mean, in Dominion, it's a little different because you can do the infinite draws.
Yeah.
So stacking your deck would be ultra powerful, but... there's another thing. You can't do that in this. So stacking
There's nothing that lets you draw cards during your turn.
So stacking your deck in this game, it removes randomness, which is actually good. It makes it more a game of skill. And it doesn't really help you cheat. It's not OP because if you give yourself a strong turn, then you still have to go through the whole deck before you can access the discard pile. You're going to have a weak turn. And it's about choosing, all right, maybe I'll take the weak turn on purpose. Maybe I'll try to mix the turns together, right? The other thing is that there's text on some of the cards that does stuff, right? But really, what the cards are...
Three currencies.
They're three different currencies.
Influence with the people, influence with the Senate, influence with the military.
And those three currencies are used to buy actions, which are the real... You have like a menu of actions that all cost action points. Some of them cost yellow, some cost red, and some cost blue. And most of them cost at least two. I don't think many of the actions cost one. So it's like, if you're, as you stack your deck, okay, I want to do this blue action, so I'll take two blue cards in my hand. I want to do that red action. Ooh, I bought a strong red card earlier in the game that is on its own worth two red. I'll put that in my hand. And I want to do this yellow action. Well, that costs three yellow. Well, I can't put six cards
in my hand. So you sort of like plan your next turn.
Right. You're picking the action points you need in currency from your deck of what's left of it anyway.
But, and here's where the game gets fascinating. Like, this is what makes this game good and why, like, we played it multiple times at a PAX when we could have played other new games. Like, it's rare we want to play the same game more than once.
We played it one and a half times.
We pretty much got to the end of that one game. It was over. The writing was on the wall. And I would play it a third time. Like, I would play this again. I like this game a lot.
Mm.
But the deck building in this game is actually a rondel builder that just happens to use cards. You're basically just building a rondel.
Yep.
And you're filling it in front of you. You're basically... And the brilliance of this is that it basically makes... the game have a very real world war game like abstraction, because the game's at essence really kind of a war game. Basically, I make my plan at the end of my turn. So I look at the board. I think about the things I want to do. I could make a really complex plan where I have the exact number of points from my hand for the next turn to do something specific and powerful. But that might not work out if someone attacks me that I didn't expect, barbarians invade, the board state changes in a radical way, and now I have to react to this terrifying new world. So I might choose instead a more safe or neutral hand to be able to be reactive. So you sort of, you plan and you invest in a path, but then you have to react to the world when your turn comes about, because if you've invested in a military in the real world, and then some shit goes down somewhere, it's not like you can just teleport those soldiers somewhere different.
Yeah, also... like we said, the Wait, the cards are currency points for buying different actions that are the actual doings.
Yep.
Right? So you start the game with, I think, 3, 3, and 3. 3 blue, 3 red, 3 yellow.
Yep.
And it pretty much takes at least 2 to do a meaningful action, you know? So you can't really do, like, all 3 different kinds of actions in one turn.
Yep.
You're like, going to have a military kind of turn or... A people kind of turn.
So you got to debate about, like, where are you going to focus? What kinds of things do you want to do? Where are you at risk?
Right. You can't balance it out. You can't be like, I'm going to do a little bit of everything every turn because your hand's not big enough. And you also can't be like, I'm going to go all military this game. It's like, okay, you go all military in turn 1 and turn 2. You have 1 red card left you can put in your hand, which does nothing. Right. You can't.
Yep.
You have to do all 3 things. And any given turn will almost definitely be not hitting on all 3 notes. It'll be each turn will be focusing on 1.5 of the areas of the game and ignoring 1 area of the game pretty much completely. Like, well, I did my military this turn. I'm not doing any next turn. I did a little bit of people this turn. I can do a little bit of people next turn, but not too much on either turn. And only in the latest late game, when you have super strong cards that you've acquired from winning already, basically, you can do a whole bunch of things in one turn.
What?
But then your next turn will still be crappy because you just spent all your huge cards in the first turn.
So kind of an aside, but I just saw this picture. I don't want to lose this train of thought. My main complaint with the game is that it has some, like, UX and mechanical problems.
Well,
like
because it looks like a Grognard war game, so all the UX and graphic design of it is Grognard-y.
Like, to know your purchasing power and everything, like, you gotta look at things, like, you have to confirm numbers several times just to make sure you're doing things right.
Yep.
And the first thing I said after I played the game once was, if you just made a simple player aid, this game would actually go a lot faster. Like,
yep.
I envisioned a very simple...
I mean, you could just take the same exact game and re-theme it.
No, the theme is perfect. I don't want a different theme.
Well, you like the theme, but the point is, if you just made it look like a Euro, right? Or like a, you know, a root style, you could totally pass this off to just everyone and it would be like a super popular game.
But the board is fine. The only... The UX...
The board's
is,
okay.
The board is fine.
It's okay.
I mean, you never actually looked at where barbarians could go was your problem.
No, I mean, I looked at it, but the point is, it's not like a beautiful board, right?
Yep.
You could give this game just a graphical-only makeover, and it could be like one of the most popular
board games. But you don't even need to change the board. You just need to make a handful of player aids that sit next to the board.
I mean,
that would have tokens on them.
That would help significantly, but I'm saying, if you just made this not look like a Roman thing.
But the problem is the UX, not the UI.
I mean, I'm just saying, to sell it.
Yeah.
No one's going to buy the Roman thing.
I mean, I'll buy the Roman thing.
The mechanics of this game are 100%.
But I'm looking at this player aid for
Euro
the
game.
AI, because you can like have an AI in the game, and it's pretty close to what I would have made as a player aid for the game itself.
Right, but I'm saying the game is, you know, it's the Roman-y parts of it are parts that Rim likes. But they're not parts that, you know, the theme is not
the
what's
theme is
you know,
pretty,
really popular.
Like, even the core mechanics are pretty tied to the theme. That's the other thing.
They are very tied to the theme, yes. But those
but that, that makes for very natural heuristics that make the game objectively better. For example, there's Italy in the middle and all the other provinces. It's a Roman crisis game. You're putting your governors out in places.
Yeah, you can make it a fantasy theme and it would be fine.
But here's the deal. One of the cool mechanics. So... One of the things you're tracking is you get points every round based on like how much control your dudes have in all the different regions and like how much you've invested into them, like having buildings and things. But you also track how many turns you were the emperor.
Yep.
Meaning you control Italy.
That's really the number one way to get points.
That is super neat. It's almost like a King of the Hill game that's happening in the middle of the rest of this game.
Right, but the thing is, right, unlike real King of the Hill, right, which has, you know, the same sort of problems as last hitting in MOBAs.
Yep. King of the Hill in this game just gets you points, but also makes you vulnerable.
It's not about, you know, King of the Hill type rules often get wrong, is that whoever's on the hill at the end wins, and that can be good, but usually it's meh.
Like,
right?
Tribe Suit is
you'll
better.
Play
it was who
really,
held the flag for the most number of seconds.
Right, it's like, you'll play really, really, really well and dominate the whole game, and then at the very end, you finally run out of steam. Someone pushes you off, and they win. They're the official winner, and that feels like bullshit, because you dominated all that time, and that seems like it was much more difficult and much more worthy of being called the winner. Right? So this game, it's like, you're getting points for the number of turns you were on top. It doesn't matter if you're there at the end, right? It just matters who is there the longest, right? The longer you're there, the better. If you get up, fall down, and get up again, and you're up there twice, that's great. That's just as being good as being up there twice as long. And even if you say, you know, dump on the last turn and have a sad ending,
yep,
you know, because Rome,
Rome,
yeah, you'll still be declared the victor.
Like
by
in the one game
the
we
most
played,
victory points.
I got into a really precarious situation, but then like everyone else got into some bullshit, and I ended up in Italy, but really weak. Mm-hmm. But everyone else was so stuck dealing with their own crap that I kind of just hung out as emperor for a few turns. Like I just held on because everyone really wanted to unseat me. But no one was willing to spend their whole turn doing it because they had other, like, much more important things to deal with.
Right, well, also, mechanically speaking, you know, there are many games out there that have a variety of victory conditions to choose from. Or if they don't have different victory conditions, they have different ways to get victory points. You could go, say, Crown of Amara. You could get bread, or you could go book, right? In this game, you could go, and as a way to get victory points, try to be the emperor the longest, and that will totally help you get a lot of victory points.
You can also be popular in the districts that you control,
or
fight barbarians.
Right, you could just be popular in a few places, or somewhat popular in a lot of places. Like, yeah, okay, Rim, you're the emperor the whole damn game, but I'm super popular everywhere else, and you're just the puppet emperor, all right?
Commodus, no!
Right.
Well,
you guys are all popular and whatever. I went around destroying all the barbarians, and all of these different ways to get points are equally strong. I can't say that like one of them is just better than the others.
Yep.
Right? It's like, yeah, you can win in any of those ways.
And one, you kind of got to balance how you're approaching the game. Two, you have to react to what the other players are doing.
Yep.
And three, the game is more like a war game in that there's a lot of random bullshit that happens.
Well, the barbarian fountains are random.
The barbarian fountains are random. The event cards are random. Mm-hmm. Like, shit just goes wrong all the time.
Yep.
Zenobia came up like right away and then was like messing with Italy in both our games just randomly. Mm-hmm. But that's fun because that uncertainty is what makes this more like a war game.
Well,
and
without
gives it more naturalistic heuristics.
Well, because of this deck stacking, right? There is no other source of randomness besides the barbarians and the event deck. Therefore, without those, you would just solve this game and be like, this is the optimal play.
Yeah.
Try to start in these places, stack your deck this way, buy these cards in this order.
Or at best, it would end up turning into Hansa Teutonica, where the game is purely reacting to what other players are doing in a cycle.
Right. Now, the randomness could affect one player more than others, But
that's war games. Sometimes shit sucks. Sometimes like Africa just gets overrun early, and that sucks if you were there.
In aggregate, it goes after everyone equally.
Yep.
So even though the barbarians happen to overrun Rim this game, right? It's like I still had to prepare just as much for barbarian invasion because it could happen at any moment.
Yep. Or if Rim, I take a risk and I like don't put any armies in Africa because I got a plan.
And then barbarians happen there. It's like, well, oops.
But maybe they don't, or maybe I got Federati and I'm good to rock. Like, going.
Yeah, but that's a gamble still.
It is a gamble.
And it's a gamble for everyone equally, even though, you know, the tide might splash upon one player and not another. Everyone still had to pay the price of gambling, you know, one way or the other, or playing it safe.
And I'm not going to explain all the mechanics. Like, I'm not going to teach you this game. That would be like a whole
video.
No,
we already taught you the core mechanic of the game is deck building game where you stack your deck, but you still can't access the discard till you play the whole
deck.
And
your buying power to buy more cards is based on your popularity and control of provinces.
Yeah, and there's several ways to get points.
And control is only
emperor,
with these.
Being popular and killing barbarians, and all three of them are equally viable ways to get points. You're probably going to have to mix it up to some extent.
And there's a bunch of fun little mechanics, like the only one I'll talk about, like, there's, you can have militias, then you got like Roman legions and all this stuff, but there's mobs.
Oh, the angry mob.
The funniest thing about a mob,
the angry mob is the fuck you stick. It's like, I want, and Rim's winning, I put mobs on Rim.
But mobs are real funny. There's other things that can cause mobs, but basically if a mob,
it's usually putting them on other players.
If a mob is in your territory, like you have a governor in a territory and there's a mob, then if you don't deal with that shit before the end of your turn, you get less popular. And if you're too unpopular, you just get replaced.
Yep.
Like you're out.
Yep.
One way to deal with a mob is to, if you have a legion there, just go kill it. Mm-hmm. But then people get pissed off.
Oh yeah, there's two different ways to remove a mob.
Or you can build circuses, you can run games.
Yeah, you can remove a mob with red military cards but that costs you popularity.
You can placate people cards.
You can placate the mob with yellow cards.
Or you can build an amphitheater and then the mobs will stay and they'll still be
a
problem.
But they won't grow.
Because Also, at the end of your turn, if any territory has a mob, it gets two mobs.
It's a bigger, angrier mob.
The mob just keeps growing until you deal with it, and the bigger.
But
it
if
is
you have a Colosseum, the mob just stays flat.
Yep.
It's like, all right, you gave me a mob, but I have a Colosseum, so it's going to be one mob.
Last game we played, I just kept a pet mob for a couple turns because I didn't want to deal with it.
Right.
It
there's also a building you can build that will deal with barbarios and convert them to your armies. As long as your army is mostly Roman, that's sustainable.
No, yeah, the card Federati will do that. The building just means when barbarians come into a territory where there's limes or limes, they'll come in flipped over, like inactive.
Yeah,
like they're
but,
not
then,
rampaging
it, but
yet.
Then they're easy to bring in.
Yeah.
Right? You don't have to fight them, right?
You can have to fight them next turn if they're still sitting there.
Yeah, but you know they'll just kill themselves effectively if you played the Federatis. Anyway,
yeah,
anyway.
There's a lot going. This game is meaty and fun. There aren't really other games like it.
Right. Don't be fooled by its grognardy war game look. It's basically an awesome Euro game, just like all those other awesome Euro games you're used to.
But with a lot of the
It's not any harder than a Dominion or a Small World.
But with a lot of the war game type mechanics that make war games interesting. There's a lot of
It's a little harder than a Splendor.
There's a lot of emergent behavior. A lot of narrative will come about. And the kind of planning you do in the game isn't the math of my next turn so much as the I need to focus on this area of the board or this type of thing next turn, and I need to be mindful of the fact that based on that, I will have fewer options until I reshuffle my deck. Yeah. So do I blow my wad now? Do I save my wad for a later turn? Yeah. What do I do?
Not enough can be said about a game. You know, there are lots of games that do this where they take a mechanic from another game and sort of let you cheat. It's like, well, that would be cheating in Dominion. So you get that extra fun of feeling like you're cheating and it's okay. But then the game is actually good, so it's not that strong.
Yep.
But it's fun to do a thing in a game that feels like cheating in the game the mechanic came from. So I feel like that's actually for game designers out there. Find a game that has a mechanic and there's like an obvious rule for that mechanic that, yeah, obviously you can't do that. That would be crazy OP and cheating, but then make a game where everyone's allowed to do that and it's not OP.
Yep. And if you keep doing that, you'll just make Dune.
Maybe.
But yeah, I feel like I want to own this game. I think our New York set would like this and play it.
Uh-huh.
And
when's
I would play
the last
it again?
Time we played any game?
In
New York.
In New York? Well, we haven't been in New York for a while is the problem. Like every weekend I've been out of town or something.
Uh-huh.
Last weekend I was skiing. So.
By the time you're ready to play a game in New York, it's going to be warm.
Yeah, but then I can easily bike to your place where there's critical mass because there are four gamers in
and
that
I
building.
I won't be there. I'll be biking.
Yeah, I'll also be biking. But then that night, we'll play a game.
I'll be sleeping.
Yeah. Don't go to bed early, old man.
I'm going to go to bed right now.
This has been Geek Nights with Rim and Scott. Special thanks to DJ Pretzel for the opening music.